Welcome to Staff Voices by the Center for Deployment Psychology. Today, Dr. David Riggs discusses the changes in the diagnostic criteria for PTSD in the DSM-5.
David Riggs, I'm the Executive Director of the Center for Deployment Psychology. Post-traumatic stress disorder, or PTSD, is a psychiatric diagnosis that develops after somebody's experienced an event that threatens their life or causes significant injury, or sometimes after they've witnessed such an event. The diagnosis of PTSD is based on a number of different criteria. In the DSM-5, it requires the occurrence of a traumatic event, and then symptoms that are present in each of four different categories of symptoms: re-experiencing, avoidance, negative shift in cognitions and emotions, and hyperarousal or increased arousal. So really, two major changes in the diagnostic criteria between DSM-4 and DSM-5. The first is a change to the way that a trauma is defined. Primarily, what happened in the DSM-5 is they removed a criteria that required an individual to report that they experienced intense emotions, particularly emotions of fear, horror, or helplessness, subsequent to the event. So now the mere presence of the event without a requirement of the emotional reaction is enough to meet the criteria that somebody's been exposed to a trauma. They also changed the trauma exposure criteria a little bit by clarifying that somebody must have either experienced the trauma directly or witnessed it directly, that has been present at the time of the trauma occurring to some other individual, or if they were exposed indirectly, that the indirect exposure relates to somebody to whom they're very emotionally close, a family member or a close friend. The second major change in the DSM-5 relative to the DSM-4 is they reorganized the ways that the symptom complaints were categorized. So in the DSM-4, there were three categories of symptoms: re-experiencing, avoidance, and arousal. In the DSM-5, they've retained the re-experiencing symptoms and the arousal symptoms largely as they were, although they added an additional arousal symptom. With regard to the avoidance symptoms, they divided those into two categories. One category is what I typically refer to as effortful avoidance, that is, that their individual is making an effort to avoid reminders or avoid remembering the events of the trauma. And the second category is this negative shift in cognition and emotion. And in addition to moving three or four of the symptoms from the old avoidance category into this new category, they added several symptoms and re-specified a couple of symptoms as well. Historically, PTSD has been categorized as an anxiety disorder, along with other anxieties like phobias and obsessive-compulsive disorder. In the DSM-5, it's now categorized with several other disorders as disorders arising in response to traumatic events. I think that this reflects a couple of things. One is a recognition that for trauma survivors, fear and anxiety is only one of the emotions that may define their experience. They may also feel a sense of guilt or shame or anger or sadness and grief, depending on what the specifics of the event are. It also reflects, I think, an acknowledgement that there are a number of psychiatric disorders that arise out of events that happen to the person or that the person experiences in life, rather than necessarily developing through only internal processes. My suspicion is that by removing the requirement that somebody acknowledge an emotional response to the trauma, it essentially will expand the proportion of the population who has, by that definition, experienced a trauma. That is, there'll be more people who've experienced events that potentially could lead to the diagnosis of PTSD because they won't have to necessarily have experienced particular emotions at the time of the trauma. Whether this is good or bad, I don't know, but it potentially increases the number of people who could develop PTSD or be diagnosed with PTSD in the larger population. So related to military trauma or combat trauma, one of the concerns that has been voiced by people who are trying to assess service members for PTSD is that the service members, particularly those who are still in uniform and those who are anticipating future combat deployments, are reticent to acknowledge the emotions that were explicitly required in DSM-4. So DSM-4 required a sense of fear or horror or helplessness in response to the trauma. And those are emotions that service members have a tendency to minimize or deny, or maybe not even feel at the time or be able to feel at the time they're going through the combat experience. So the concern was that PTSD would be underdiagnosed if you actually require those emotional reactions. When service members are asked about their combat experiences, they're more often to report a sense of going on automatic pilot or simply that their training kicked in at the time that the enemy was engaged or that they experienced an ambush or explosion or whatever it might be. So it's potentially the case that we'll more accurately capture some cases of PTSD because those individuals won't have to acknowledge those feelings. Assessment tools designed for the DSM-4 won't necessarily be useful in making diagnoses based on the DSM-5. Those people who've developed assessment tools will be revising them and revalidating those assessment tools as we move forward, but there will be, at least for a period of time, we'll have tools that are effective for diagnosing PTSD in the world of DSM-4, but won't necessarily have those tools that are available for the DSM-5 diagnosis right away. The diagnostic criteria themselves, the changes that have been made, do raise the number of possible combinations of symptom complaints that would qualify somebody to be diagnosed with PTSD. There are, you have four symptom categories, but somebody doesn't have to have all of the symptoms in each category to be diagnosed with PTSD. Just the way the symptoms are arranged and the criteria that are required to meet the diagnostic cutoffs suggests that clinicians will see more variability in presentation of individuals who might both meet criteria for PTSD when they're treating it. That is that two individuals both coming in, both diagnosed with PTSD, might be presenting with quite different symptom pictures than one another.
For more information on this and other relevant topics, please visit the CDP website at www.deploymentpsych.org.